start zones and things of that nature. There'll be an opportunity as people speak and we introduce people around. Come on in. Reverend Chair, thank you. You have a chance to answer questions later as they come up. Some sheets we passed out that we'll work with that. Wanted to introduce you to some folks, Dr. David Brown. He is adjunct professor of William & Mary, Fairfield Corporation, this kind of thing.
Keep going.
Don't have to do the whole list.
No. Nobody needs that much time taken away.
Mike, where are you? Roe, there he is. Well, Mike, thanks you guys for coming tonight. Kevin Zoll, new guy on the street. Glad to have you aboard.
Thank you.
No relation to the people who make those wines up that way, right?
No, of course they don't.
And I want to introduce you also to our folks here. Lori Black and Dee Russell are right here. They're going to do the meat of this program. They're so talented. And we thank you. Lori, I'm going to turn it over to you.
Absolutely.
You're up next.
I'm up. Tag, you're it.
And,
good evening, everybody. We're so glad to see everyone here. When we talk about the word historic, we frequently think of landscapes or buildings. We don't think about communities. But however, when we're talking about Gwynn's Island and a historic district of Gwynn's Island, we're looking at the historical value of the community's whole environment, which includes buildings, lands, culture, and its history. Now, many people get confused of what being a historic means and what it doesn't mean. I laughed. I spoke to Mr. Burdett earlier this evening. Mr. Burdett, I don't know if anybody looks on Facebook, but he posted this document, which we printed in the back. And it's kind of overwhelming if you're not sure what we're talking about, but we're talking about the two columns in the middle. And when you turn the next page, all of the scary stuff isn't in those two columns. So that's what we're talking about. So what does listing a property or having a historic on Gwynn's Island mean? What it does mean, it's strictly honorary. That's all it is. It's an official recognition of the historic significance of the island's complete community environment. It encourages but does not require that you are actually doing anything preservation to your property. You're not required to update or do anything preservation to your property. It offers limited protection of properties for potential harmful federal and state funded activities, and it may qualify owners for tax credits, which is extremely important. What it's not, which is even more important than what it is for most people, it does not prevent you as an owner from renovating, painting, demolishing your home. You can still paint your house orange if you choose to. There's nothing about being a historic district that prevents that. It does not require you to restore or renovate your property. It does not restrict on how you use your property. It does not dictate to local government or require them to create a historic ordinance for the area. Nor does it give government the authority to create historic preservation programs or locally controlled, those are all locally controlled decisions. Okay? So as we're going through this program, and the meat of this program is actually going to be Dr. Brown's, because he is what I call the SME. He is the subject matter expert. I know you hate that, but we're going to give it to you anyway. So, we're just here to help outline and kind of guide this meeting a little bit. So we're gonna ask you to hold all your questions to the end because we think that a lot of your questions will be answered by the program itself. We will keep it short, sweet, to the point. We would like to know at there anybody that has a specific concern of what a historic district is and what it isn't? Not specific to your property, but specific to what you think it won't let you be. Anybody? That's good.
Good
we
job.
Like that. All right, so we want to make sure that we cover all of your concerns. I'm going to turn it over to Lori, and she's going to discuss the steps to becoming a historic district. And then Dr. Brown is going to talk a little bit more, and then we'll open it up for questions. The handouts are in the back. If you didn't get one, please feel free. If we, in fact, didn't print enough, make sure to leave your contact information, and we'll be glad to email you one. And we're going to put everything on the Preservation Mathews website by tomorrow, maybe the next day.
Yeah, maybe Saturday. The whole work thing.
Exactly, work.
Yeah.
Lori?
Good evening, everyone. I'm Lori Jackson Black, and I am a professional genealogist and historian by trade, and one of the co-founders of Preservation Mathews. And some of the things that we want to talk about, the benefits of becoming a historic district. So why it's an honorific to become a historic district, there are actually some benefits to those historic districts if they choose to use them. Some of those are economic benefits. There are opportunities to obtain state and federal rehabilitation tax credits. Dee alluded to that a little bit. And then there's also something called state historic preservation easements. And so once you're a historic district or you have a house that's a historic house on its own, those are some of the things that you can take advantage of. Another benefit is that it promotes heritage tourism. When you have a historic district, all the history geeks like me, we go nuts. We always look them up. We say, where can we go see all these cool things? And so it's really an opportunity to tell people and let them know what you have in your community. And then another benefit is a community identity. It helps solidify the identity of a community coming together as a whole, working to save historic structures. So what are the steps to becoming a historic district? Well, we've already gotten started here. The preliminary information form was done in 2017, and it was approved by the State Department of Historic Resources in March of 2017. So what's next? Well, that's why we're here. We want to know from you, what do you want on Gwynn's Island? Do you want to pursue the complete nomination process to become a registered historic district? So now I'm going to turn it over to Dr. David Brown. He is co-director of the Fairfield Foundation and one of the co-authors of the preliminary information form that was submitted on Gwynn's Island. So Dr. Brown.
Thank you. Video. Yeah, it's late, and so it's one of those moments where it's nice to be surrounded by friends so that you can go and talk about a couple of things that maybe folks have some thoughts about, experiences with. I'm as here as much to learn as I am to talk, and so when folks were introducing me before, saying I'm a subject matter expert, I guess technically that is correct. I do this for a living. I work with communities, and I work with them to understand the process, and then I help them if they want to pursue that process. And I've worked all over the state to do this, and I've worked on individual properties, and I've worked on big districts. So we've worked on one up in Fauquier in Prince William County, the Broad Run Little Georgetown Rural Historic District right near Manassas Gap. And you know, 10,000 acres and you know, hundreds and hundreds of properties, and working with those communities to kind of find a way to recognize the historic character of those places. Same time, we do really tiny ones. We worked with the Rosenwald School over in Gloucester, known as Woodville. In fact, that was the first one I ever got a chance to be a part of. So I'm going to try to bring the 20-plus years of experience I have to the table and try to share what I can with all of you, particularly during the question and answer period. Because not everybody loves historic districts, but a lot of that loss of love is based on just an understanding of what they see in the press and understanding what they see in popular culture. And my attempt is to try to kind of address some of those questions because I'm here in front of you. I'm not a bureaucrat. I'm not somebody who works for the state. And so I can give you usually some examples to go by as to why, you know, that's my understanding. And then maybe some resources you can go to if you need an independent voice outside of my own. wonderful opportunity back in 2016, 2017 when the Hurricane Sandy grant funds came through the state. And the state was thinking that the best thing they could do is to go ahead and better understand the architecture of Mathews County. And so they commissioned the organization I work with to go ahead and to do what's called an architectural survey of the county. And that's not looking at every single building. What it is it's looking at some of the cream of the crop. So we worked with the county to look at the overall dates of different buildings, and we tried to get stuff from every different period. And we tried to spread it out all over Mathews County, and we got a chance to do quite a few of them here on Gwynn's Island. What they wanted to do in addition to that, though, was they wanted to see if there were specific themes or places within Mathews County that were deserving of examination as districts. And so, like, the one that I picked immediately because I fell in love with the place, and I know you're supposed to have me say Gwynn's Island right there. It's like, no, I fell in love with Mob Jack. I immediately drove down there, and I was like, what the heck? There's gridded streets and tiny little place in Mathews County. What is this? Now, eventually, I made it to Gwynn's Island, but you know, that initial introduction to Mathews in a way that was special and different and wasn't just Main Street was an inspiration to me. So we looked at that as a potential district, and we did a lot of work in that and filled out what's called a preliminary information form. And then we did one for Mathews downtown. Obviously, that was a necessary one. We also did one for gas stations and car-related infrastructure in the county. And so it was looking at car dealerships, gas stations, a little bit of everything, because frankly, we had just bought the gas station that we were restoring, and it was kind of, you know, something we thought other people might be interested in trying to save because these buildings were getting torn down at a fairly frequent rate. The last two, one was African-American schools and churches, and I can talk about that another time, fascinating in its own right, but the fifth one was Gwynn's Island. And we had heard enough and seen enough in the museum and seen and met enough of our friends, most of which were folks who came here to visit, not to stay, that it gave us an opportunity. It's like, we need to talk to the folks who are actually there. And we got to meet some of you, not all of you, because that preliminary information form is essentially an introduction. The state would like to know if this has a good reason to move to the next level. And in fact, it came up with a form so that when the private individual was wondering if their house or their neighborhood was worthy of the status, that they could put together just enough information for the state to be able to say, whoa, your place is worthless, you should stop. Or they could say, wow, these are the things that make us who we are. These are the stories, these are the people, this is the architecture or the archaeology that helps us understand who we are as a people, who we are as a community. And in those instances, that form, as it gets filled out, as cursory as it can be, you know, can bring together enough when the state gives it its thumbs up. Essentially what they're saying is we are now going to have our staff there for you as the community moves forward, helping you navigate the complex process of putting this nomination together and eventually getting it on both the state's list, which is called the Virginia Landmarks Register, and the federal list, which is the National Register of Historic Places. These are both honorific, and as was explained earlier, they're largely used as triggers for both recognition programs. People want to celebrate the history of their area, which translates to tourism or translates to other positive benefits, or the contrary, not contrary, or an alternative to that is that it triggers certain federal government programs or state government programs in which there are tax credits and other incentives to treat these buildings differently. And one of the things I wanted to highlight from that also is there are a couple of other things that this triggers, and in some cases it can be very important in the years to come. In the flooding ordinance, the floodplain ordinance, there's actually a condition in there for historic structures. And they have a very specific set of criteria that you have to meet in order to be an historic structure. And contributing resources to an historic district that's listed on the state or the federal listing qualify. And so for particular individuals in the community who are thinking like, okay, well, a cataclysmic event is going to come up and it's going to hurt my house, I would like to have as much flexibility as I can, including its historic character, to justify alternatives, meaning that there is more of a selection for me to choose of rather than just what I see as, you know, you got to take it down, or you're going to have to lift it up, or you're going to have to do something that the county thinks independent of its history. And my preference as an individual, as a property owner, has always been to try to give people as many options as they can to preserve that historic integrity and to argue for. And ultimately, that's what this process is. If you decide as a community community that this is an area you want to invest. The key is arguing for the things that you love. It's going to be talking to people who live up in a state or the federal government and telling them why Gwynn's Island is so darn important. Because most of them are just waiting to hear. They can't go out there and tell you why it's important outside of the most, you know, top-of-the-line historical things that they may have heard of. So they might have heard about Revolutionary War and how the English were camped here, and they might have seen maybe the map that Thomas Jefferson drew, or they might have heard about some of the more national or statewide events that took place here. If they're really cool, they know something about the Oyster Wars, which I didn't learn about until we were writing the form. In fact, most of them probably know Gwynn's Island because they spent a week there, or they came down and they were staying at, you know, one of the beach houses, or it just came as the recreational spot that it's become for so many people today. And so there is this idea of what it means to folks, and it's not just the residents here, and it does percolate, but the residents and the people in the Mathews community who love Gwynn's Island are best to argue for its preservation and recognition. So that preliminary information form, it's available. The state has it online. Mathews Preservation also has, Preservation Mathews also has it accessible. And frankly, if you want to reach out to me personally, you know, dave@fairfieldfoundation.org. I'm happy to go ahead and send it to you. It was an honor to co-author it, and something that taught me a lot about the community. Now, the question that comes next is, what needs to be done to complete the nomination? The preliminary information form is relatively small. There was about 66 properties that were surveyed and put into the state's inventory system so that we could specifically cite the characteristics of those buildings in the argument for the architectural integrity. The archaeological integrity was argued through the fact that there are already about 20 known archaeological sites, meaning those that are in the state's inventory. Inventory is just a list. It's not even honorific in any degree. It's just the fact that some people have thrown some information up to the state. State people put it on a form, put it in a file. Those 20 sites and those 66 architectural resources gave the state enough of an understanding in the way that they read those forms to say, okay, yes, this works. But for a National Register listing, you have to go ahead and document everything within the district. Every standing structure within the district. Most of these structures would be what's called non-contributing. And the state and the Fed have an idea of how you define historic. And in most cases, historic has to be at least 50 years old. So I am 6 years from becoming historic. Some of you in here are closer to historic than I am.
Some of us are prehistoric.
So what we do is we go in, when my organization does an historic district, what we have to do is we have to fill out a form for each individual property. And when folks started asking me about how much it would cost to go ahead and do a district for Gwynn's Island, I went over to the county and I asked them to pull up their GIS and I said, give me a raw count of how many parcels on Gwynn's Island and a little bit of Cricket Hill, because obviously that's important because of the Revolutionary Army that's on that side and connects to the entire story and the history there. How many properties are on the island that have something built on? And they gave me a raw number, I think about 3 years ago, of 712. Now, my sense is that the number is actually a little bit less than that, because some of that might be long stretches of buildings that are divided up and that are condos, and there could be some overlap in the context of things like campgrounds and other things where they might have small buildings that aren't really technically seen as individual properties, even though the parcel lines might be as such. So let's imagine that it may be a more reasonable number of around 650, because there is certainly a lot of buildings. You've got about 66 properties that are already inventory. That leaves you with, let's say, just a nice round figure of 600 properties. When my organization goes out and budgets to look at filling out the form and doing all the necessary documentation per property, it's around $100 to $125 per property. It takes about 8 hours to go ahead and fill out the form, which encompasses to fill out a form, submit the form, print the photos, do the site plans, do the descriptions, and actually visit. And so that 8 hours plus that person's time equals that amount. So that there's your peering into my budgeting process for something like this. We are one of the least expensive organizations on the east side of Virginia. folks that usually based out of Norfolk, some of the folks based out of Richmond, some that are closer to Williamsburg. You know, we're right here in Gloucester, so we don't have some of the kind of costs involved, but you know, 100 to 125 is usually a nice ballpark. And as you can see, as soon as you do that times 600 properties, that's an expensive amount. So the inventory is necessary because the folks who are at the state are understanding that once you're inside that district, every contributing resource can qualify for tax credits. If they do a rehabilitation process and they go through that project context, and I can go all about what that means in detail because we did it for the gas station down on the corner in Gloucester, you know, they have to have it. It's the baseline of information for that. So this is part and parcel with understanding the district. The non-contributing resources, you know, it's a really preliminary, it's a form that focuses only on the exterior. It's basically baseline documentation, not too dissimilar from what you would see the county compile, and in some cases even less information from what is in the county's records itself. Although it's a little bit different, so it's not as if we can just go into the county's GIS and fill out all the forms without leaving my desk. That would be fantastic. But then I wouldn't get to meet so many people in Mathews. That inventory is the lion's share of what a nomination process includes. Because after that, there's a long form, not super long, but long enough that you're talking about, you know, give me a summary of all of the architecture on the island. It's usually 5 or 6 pages in narrative form talking about how the tradition of architecture on the island has proceeded. And there's another section that talks about the areas of significance. And that's all of the important elements that the island represents. That's where you talk about the Revolutionary War, but it's also where you talk about the Oyster Wars. You talk about the important people, so they would get paragraphs so that we could make sure that they were recorded for people who are interested in the history of Gwynn's Island looking at the future. And then you'd also talk about the archaeological sites. You talk about what times do they represent, what cultures do they represent. And then finally, the architecture is looked at again, but instead of just a description, now you're going to talk about why Gwynn's Island is cool. And this is really where the arguments come into place, because the National Register of Historic Places can understand that the reason this place is cool is because it's cool at the local level. Meaning you do not have to have Monticello on your island to be important. That is a national level architectural significance. And you do not have to have something that is at statewide significance to be on the register. Because get this, communities, as defined by the state of Virginia, are really important. And their histories are important. As they see their histories, they are important. And so part of my task is to work with the community to argue for its importance. And the pure result being the honorific, and hopefully maybe some incentive programs that people can engage with at a later date. So the nomination can be complicated. But at its core, it's really talking about building stories together and making an argument for why this place is important, covering just enough so that we get that broad coverage where everyone feels like at least most of these stories that we've heard across our years are researched and put on paper. And it becomes a bit of a time capsule for folks who are looking to learn more about a place. And that last form where you're putting all the research together at the end is usually somewhere between $5,000 and $10,000. The reason that sometimes it goes a little bit higher is because the state and the feds go ahead and mandate that you, in this process of nominating, are going to communicate with every single property owner who would be involved with this, period. And every single neighbor. So the notification process that's involved in this, first and foremost, includes at least, if not one, then at least more than one public meeting in which the community is invited to come out and to ask questions about what's going on there. Because these processes, if the community engages, finds the money, gets the contract together, and moves forward, is essentially 50% plus one rules the day. And so you want to have as much public engagement as possible, because you don't want people who be angry about it happening, unless they're angry about it happening for specific reasons and they've got all the right to do it. Because in that case, you know, that as long as they're informed and they disagree, I have a hard time arguing with them at the table. I'd rather have somebody yell at me about something that they feel is just contrary to me rather than arguing with me about something that's a misunderstanding. The second thing is that when we make sure that people are notified through public meetings, the complement is individual letters to every single property owner on the island. We as the contractors, I'm just pretending in that case, I would have to go to the clerk's office in Mathews, and I would have to record the date on which I went ahead and parcel owner on the island, period. Can't go online and use the GIS, can't get a county person to go ahead and pull the files for me. I have to go in and flip through the book and make sure I get everybody on that date. And then a letter is sent out to them that says, if you disagree with this, this is your opportunity to go ahead and to write down or to come in person to the meeting and state that you disagree. And it doesn't mean you have a reason one way or Sunday. You could just come in and say, I don't want this. And so that your number can be counted, like most in our democracy can. In addition to that, every single neighbor outside of the district, which is kind of silly when you're talking about an island, but we are talking about a couple of parcels that would be on the outside of the island up on Cricket Hill, the folks who are outside of the district but who are neighbors would also get a letter in the mail, and they can ask that their opinion be considered in this process. And so the last thing the state wants to do is to kind of sneak something by. And so they put us through this arduous process to make sure that the public has a voice. At the very least, it can be a recorded voice, even if 99% of the people on the island say they want it, that 1% can still be heard, and that is an important thing in our society. So I've gone a little bit over cost, I've gone a lot over process. I know it's a lot of information to absorb, and this is usually a level of detail most people never get introduced to. But at this point, I want to take a little bit of a step back on it. I do have, I guess, one major point to bring up that hopefully won't disable the conversation about how one pays for such a thing, but hopefully will give hope. Everybody here remember Hurricane Michael? I had forgotten about Michael, so my apologies. Everybody remember Hurricane Florence? I did not forget about Hurricane Florence. So the federal government put aside money from both hurricane funds to go to states that were affected by them to address specifically historic resources and the effects on historic resources. And the first priority is to reach out to property owners whose properties are already listed on the National Register of Historic Places or the Virginia Historic Landmarks Register. And if they have receipts and other things that were costs directly related to repairs from those hurricanes, then they can petition the state for compensation related to those costs. The state is historically bad at letting people know that these funds exist. So this happened with Hurricane Sandy. And a lot of folks were just like, well, my property wasn't on the National Register. Or my property was old, but I didn't even know this fund was available. And so part of my job as a non-for-profit director is to say, well, I'm going to be a bit of a megaphone for the state, because I think this is important for our community to know. The Hurricane Mike and Hurricane Flo, as they call it, the Mike and Flo Fund, is coming down the pipe now. And the state is hiring a manager at the Department of Historic Resources to try to manage the system as it goes through, because there's about 45 counties that have access to these funds, and Mathews is one of them. So if and when they're able to look at all of the folks who are petitioning for some kind of compensation related to damage on their National Register eligible homes, and they have the receipts still, which I can't imagine most people do, but some of us have a shoebox full of those. After that is kind of extinguished, those things are covered, the remaining funds are put aside for survey and planning, because they want to make sure that communities are prepared in the future and that property owners are better understanding of the history of their properties in relation to how the state defines it, which is important for money. So in this instance, it would be plausible that Mathews would approach the state and say, well, we'd like some of those funds to go towards putting together a full nomination for Mathews, Gwynn's Island. And then it would be a competition amongst the many other counties that are anxious to go and to work towards similar projects where they're inventorying historic resources, using state funds to better understand where the significance is for these places. So I can't promise that there would be any money spent from that on to projects here in Mathews County. But what I'm hoping for is that it could be, and that there's a voice at the table that should be advocating for that, not just for Gwynn's Island. Mathews has a lot of awesome history that should be recognized for it. I will shake my fist at Gloucester County, because Gloucester County is not on any of the lists. It wasn't for Sandy, it wasn't for Mike, it wasn't for Flo, and I'm having a hard time believing that somehow Mathews was qualifying and Gloucester isn't, but I will blame Gloucester for that, and not Mathews. So I'll conclude with the fact that I'm optimistic that there are some funds that come down the pipe, but I think it should still be a community's decision when approach a situation like this where an honorific is could be bestowed and that that honor could then trickle down to benefit folks in other ways. And now I'll stop talking for a little bit unless I can answer questions.
I was gonna say, don't go, because we know most of the questions are yours.
I'll get you.
I was gonna say, the only thing that we want to point out at this point, we unfortunately cannot speak to specific properties or homes. This is just general information. If you have a specific question about your home or your property, leave your information on the back and we'll certainly reach back out to you. Because it could get very tedious going to every single property in the room this evening. So anyone has questions, please feel free.
And on a follow-up to that, if you guys wonder if somebody has ever inventoried your property on the island before, even off the island, reach out to me. It's I run a not-for-profit, so it's not something I charge people to do. This is I'm a preservationist. So if the state has a file on your home, I'd be happy to go ahead and pull the file because I have access to their database and make sure that that information is also in your hands. And it could have been a previous property owner, or it could have been some other scenario, I don't understand which. Most people in my firm, in my world of architectural history and landscape preservation, when they're doing a form for the state, they typically are knocking on your door and talking with you about it. On occasion, somebody might say, well, I can take a photograph from the right of way, so as long as I'm not trespassing, I'll fill out a form. Those forms might have errors. You might be able to correct those errors. Those forms might have information that might be of benefit to you. So, you know, I just want to offer that up as something that I'm happy to go ahead and connect you with. Please just let me know. I'm happy to be of service. Yes, sir.
Since that time, houses have been added on to, new houses built. Would you still consider the Gwynn's Island Estate's initial fishing cottages as historic? Built back in the 50s, there's photographs in the museum of a few houses around the Keeble House, which of course is historic, but those cottages are now, you know, good-sized homes. Been added on to many, many times. So, I guess, is that, are you looking at that as a historical area?
So, the short answer is yes. To build it into the broader question that would hopefully inform others in the room, you know, what happens if I had a tiny home that had been added on to and added on to and added on to? Is it the first period that makes it historic? Is it the second period? Is it the third period? Because the federal government usually uses the 50-year rule as the first point of discussion for when something's historic. The key is how many different additions came on before that 50-year block. So what predates 1970? Everything before 1970 would get the first hardest look, and we'd see, well, how much of that is left? So if you have one window in your house that was from a wall from 1917, but the rest of it is 2018, then I use a ludicrous example to kind of paint a picture as to how that won't, in and of itself, make you have an historic building. But you may have an historic archaeological site, you may have other elements to the building that make it important, whether it's association with a historic figure or historic event. Now, if you've got more ambiguity when it comes to it, so let's imagine that you've got, let's say, 30% of your house, and you've got a couple of big additions. It's possible that it could still be contributing, but this is where you get into a mode of talking with the property owner and starting to ask, well, what do you think? Yeah, how much do you want us to argue for this? Because in those instances, we have an opportunity to dig deeper into the history of that parcel, where in most cases for an historic district of this size, we're not really going and doing a ton of individual histories. So if you've got an area where historically there was all of these little fishing cottages together, to me, that's the main story, is that each of those individual houses, while each one is cool, even if it's been expanded, the intent of that original community was one that deserves of attention, and so that's what I would bring to the forefront in the nomination. And then the question of what's contributing versus not, which is on an individual property or individual building basis, well, that can be a little bit different. I can talk and
more the history than the building, okay?
Correct.
For example, Captain Kimball's well sits beside the road.
Yeah.
It's still there. I was down there today.
In it?
Yeah, it's still.
Like at the bottom?
I had the hope when I was president of Civic League 30 years ago, it was still looked down into it, and I got the state to fill the hole in with some rocks. But
yeah,
to me, that ought to have a historical sign. The Edwood Cemetery is another spot, the Kiva Cemetery. There's a black cemetery black in the woods. That's part of the history, you know, on Gwynn's Island.
And so architectural inventory forms are usually broken up into three different groups, or four different groups technically. You have buildings, you have structures, and you have objects.
Okay, gotcha.
And so buildings are anything that people live in, or anything that people operate in. Structures are usually things that people don't really operate in. So a windmill is a structure. Unless, of course, it's like a Dutch windmill and you can live inside it. Houses, even sheds and barns are buildings because you have people operating within them. And then objects are things like a well. In this instance, can be a structure if it's above ground. Objects are more like sculpture, walls, things like that. So there's a little bit of overlap, but we're capturing all of them. And so especially if there's a particular significance for something that's now kind of out of context. Like you have a wall that's going through a forest and then you've just got it surrounded by 20th century houses, but you know that wall dates the 18th century. You know, that would be something that you'd want to go ahead and highlight separate from everything else because it stands out and could be lost. But it's important to the historical context even though it's now in a different era.
Thank
more
you.
Questions?
I'm not even sure if this is an appropriate way to divorce this. But across the street from us, in Gwynn's Island, there is a cemetery. It is deeded on the plaque as part of the Gwynn's Island Cemetery. I don't think 99% of people know about it. We have actually seen, 30 years ago, the graves of British soldiers who died on Gwynn's Island during the Revolutionary War. It's not being tended. It's not designated. It's covered with trash and debris and junk cars. And shouldn't that be brought forth? Should the Gwynn's Island Cemetery Committee do it? Should you all? How do we do this?
All right, so let me tie this first back into the premise here for what that changes if it's in an historic district. So if a property like that is being neglected but has historic significance and is noted within an historic district, and now you have a National Register status to it, unfortunately, nothing changes on that. There's no way from the National Register's perspective to go ahead and to force someone who owns that property to properly maintain it in a fashion that the other members of the community wish.
The Gwynn's Island Cemetery owns it. It's deeded to them in the center of this plot.
So what I would say is the recognition of it and bringing the focus of the community to that would typically help that community respond to the need. And so the one function that the National Register process would do is it would highlight its significance. But it wouldn't actually produce any kind of laws or motivating factor to have that organization that owns it do anything with it. And that's the frustrating part, but also how this is a respect of property rights within the system. So
it's
in a sense,
a fabulous site, you just can't see it.
Well, and this is what's so frustrating about things like historic cemeteries. You know, I've worked on the Brooks Family Cemetery down at New Point. And essentially once every 10 years, we're probably going to clear it and go to go ahead and appreciate the awesomeness that is that cemetery. And then Mother Nature's gonna take it back because nobody lives there, nobody maintains it. The property owners are not interested in, that I know of, in doing it. And actually the property is now owned by the Nature Conservancy. And they're more focused on things that are not related to the historic qualities of it. They're interested in the natural qualities of it. So we're stuck in a situation, particularly with historic cemeteries, on how to care for them. And even when they're owned by a group that has, essentially, the historic cemetery's maintenance as the premise, it takes the community to advocate to get them to go ahead and change things. And the National Register process actually can't get them to do anything more about it other than, in a sense, kind of embarrass them into doing think she covered some of the cemeteries, and of course a couple of the big ones, just because it was necessary to make sure the state knew that cemeteries were a prominent resource on the island.
Well, the homeowner took us over one day and showed it to us, and I was dumbfounded. I couldn't imagine that that was there and wasn't, you know, fenced in or cared for or anything.
That's when reaching out to some of the historic nonprofits that we do have, like Preservation Mathews, and to come talk to us about that, because we know other groups and people, and especially if we can get the history of the cemetery with the British soldiers, then that will open up a lot of public interest. And that, you know, there are groups that do public cleanup days once a year. So once a year, you could get a group of volunteers to go out and clean it up and get it show worthy, and then promote it as part of the history of the island, and you get tourists that would come to see the British soldiers.
Oh yeah.
Absolutely.
I'd like to make a comment on that, okay? Have you contacted the Civic League to do anything about it? I was president for 13 years, and I've never heard of that cemetery.
No.
We have the Keeble Cemetery,
no,
we have the Edward Cemetery.
Anything. I thought the Gwynn's Island Civic Association knew that part
no,
of the Gwynn's Island Cemetery.
Like I said, I was president
was
13 years, and I've never heard of it.
Okay.
Thank you for bringing it up.
Yeah, I know how to reach you. Preservation Mathews will come find you.
If it comes about where you understand that there are human remains that are eroding, you know, my organization does do a lot with sites that are eroding, particularly with human remains, let us know, because in that instance, documenting them either as they're eroding or working with the owners on the proper treatment of those impacted deposits is a crucial thing in trying to understand how to go
through. To the Civic Association, you wouldn't approach the homeowner, you'd go to the Civic Association.
Correct.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, we're used to things like if it's eroding into the York River, there's a site in Guinea that has had bodies eroding from it for years, and in most cases, the property owners are not going to change anything with it, and Mother Nature is taking its toll. It's an expensive process to exhume bodies and then finding the ancestors the descendants. And then also looking for reburial and all of that process. So at the same time, we know that knowingly desecrating a cemetery is a felony. But negligence in the maintenance of a cemetery is a wiki sticky. So one has to find a way to go ahead and document that in a different way. Like if somebody came through and ripped up all the gravestones, broke them in half, and then went into the crypts and started throwing the bodies everywhere, that's obviously a noble desecration. And there's some 16-year-old boys out there that are probably guilty of that. They were not knowing what they were doing at the time. But then in instances like just having something disappear slowly amongst the dirt, you know, in some cases, it's hard to prove that there's an active process of destruction in that. So cemeteries are not an easy subject to deal with, but let us know if there's some additional assistance that's needed. And between our friends at Mathews and what we do with the state, we're happy to work with folks.
I'll talk to Jane and
you. Yes, you had a question.
Being that it's an island, how do you classify a beach as far as beach? How does that affect the beaches?
It's a good question. I think as far as this, this is an island. There are beaches. How do we treat our historic beaches? Okay. And I think, honestly, that's it's an excellent question, because one of the themes that you talk about in a nomination would be recreation, because people have been coming to Gwynn's Island to enjoy the beaches for a very long time. Well, there's not much beach left sometimes. I'd say that there's two things to do. The first is acknowledging that the state is typically really supportive of National Register nominations, and the state may be technically owners of a certain amount of the beach as it extends further from the property. So I don't think there's going to be an argument from the state for having it included as far as a vote at the table for, you know, whether or not Gwynn's Island's boundary should include low mean water or further. The state also is hoping to go ahead and get their first underwater archaeologist position brought and instituted back into the Department of Historic Resources since the mid-1980s. And so in that case, if there are archaeological resources that are eroding out, it certainly is an important opportunity to make sure those are included. And then it's just a question of making making sure that you're looking at things like docks and other structures that start on one side and extend out so that they're included within it. And most docks, after so many storms, they're going to be essentially non-contributing structures, but we have to include them within the inventory. And the off chance that you have one that does or has lasted for as long as it has, you know, that's where you want to focus and making sure that it's appreciated, because as we're looking at the past, we don't want to just ignore some things that seem to be commonplace because there's so few of them left of that age. You know, some oyster houses in Mathews still have a lot of age to them, but it doesn't matter if it's decrepit, they'll get the fire department in and practice on it. And I mean, they're not the only community to do that. I mean, it's a common practice. It's an old building. You need some practice with your fire department. It's kind of sad, but it's not doing it to be evil. They're just doing it because they're trying to practice. So it's working with folks and acknowledging those historic elements and seeing the stuff that may be typical and as maybe perhaps worth saving more than we thought. There's an oyster tarnet furnace. I think there's one on Mathews Island, but I know there's other ones that are just remarkable because just for some folks who have always used them, it's commonplace. But for anybody who's not from Mathews, they're like, what the heck is this? You know, what industrial madness is occurring right on the edge of the beach? And I think there's a couple of them that are left that are just pretty amazing. Then again, you have a lot of folks from outside coming in amazed at the mystery that is Gwynn's Island. And you're like, yeah, calm down, people. It's Gwynn's Island. So, yes, ma'am. You don't really understand, do you say the basis?
No.
Oh, the base for this, yeah. So, the ideal situation for a community like this is that you bind together to say that this is something that we want. And then you advocate within your political system to go ahead and have an expense of this size shared in some way by everyone. And the best way to do that is to go ahead and to advocate to the locality and to say, look, we think some of the county's funds should be going for this because it helps people of all levels. You know, it's like if somebody was putting up, putting a sidewalk on Main Street kind of thing. You know, everybody gets to walk on that sidewalk. It benefits so many people that we understand it to be a shared cost. And essentially, some of the funds I'm talking about now, I call it the Mike and Flo Fund. You know, that's federal taxes that they've decided to go ahead and to give to help communities that were impacted by a horrible event, in this case, Hurricane Mike or Hurricane Flo. So it's taking tax dollars, which is essentially coming from all of us, as well as everyone else in the United States, and then making it available through the state to help with preservation-related things like this. That's probably the least painful of those processes because, you know, frankly, we're all frustrated with taxes at some point in our life, whether we're just introduced to it when we, you know, turn 16 or 17, all the way up. The other possibility that people have done in the past is they found somebody rich who's willing to do it for the entire place. It's rare, but it's happened before. You know, we did an historic district over in Brewington, which is in King and Queen County, and it's about 5,000 acres, and it covers about, I'd say, 70 properties, and it was paid for by two people. And it, you know, it was something where they advocated. They walked around their community members, they asked them if it was something that they thought they could support, and then they had the money to go about paying for a contractor to go ahead and do the job. So those are two really disparate examples.
Well, how much seed money would be necessary for this section?
So, excellent question. So the preliminary information form cost $4,000 3 years ago. And what has happened since then, if you're looking at the general cost, is you're looking at two primary components, and that would be the inventory and then the full nomination write-up. And the inventory looks like if it's gonna be 600 properties and it's $125 a pop, you know, you're looking, anybody wanna do quick math for me? 600 times 125?
Somewhere between 60 and 70,000.
So $60,000 to $70,000 for the inventory, and then probably add another 10 in for writing it all up. So if you're looking at, let's say, $80,000 to go ahead and do the district, that's expensive. You know, but it's also 600 plus properties, and so it has the potential to benefit a whole lot more people than just doing it for a single property.
And everything sounds good, but are there any downsides to it?
Any downsides to it?
There has to be something.
Okay. say that the first downside that I've had people voice their concern about to me has been a misconception that then breeds into people's understanding of how their property operates. So I'll give you an example, because examples are easier to go. Somebody wants to buy property in the community, and they say, oh, it's in an historic district. Oh, they're not going to let me paint my house orange. And that's a horrible situation, because it's a miscommunication of what an historic district does. But you asked for a negative, and I wanted to give you a firm example, because that's where you do have the problem of how do you go ahead and communicate the significance beyond it. And you're right, there's almost always going to be a negative at some point. And this is kind of a silly negative, but I don't want to go ahead and pull the wool over anybody's eyes on this. You know, you're always going to have to explain to somebody, like, my house is on the side of a hill. We spent a lot of money making sure drainage was there so that somebody who bought the house in the future wouldn't worry about my house sliding down the hill. And yet, some people are going to look at my house when I go to sell it, and they're going to be like, I don't trust that. I'm not buying your house is on the side of the hill. So it takes that historic district to go ahead and to continue to talk about what it means and to make sure it's clear to people in the future. So it's a bit of a burden on folks to be clear about that. I don't think that's an arduous task, but I do think it's one that people have cited to me that they've been concerned about. I think they get more out of it than they don't, but it is something that should be talked about.
Related to that, is it enhance control of governments over the district, over the property?
Okay, honest question, and one that almost always comes up. And the short answer is no. And I will say this, and this is what I've learned over 20 years. There is no correlation between getting an historic district status and the locality coming in and deciding to embrace a more stringent zoning regulation. There just isn't. It has happened from time to time, because how can you come up with the, they won't let me paint my house orange? How does that example come about? Most people understand that example is from Savannah. Savannah, Georgia has specific ordinances in place that control what you can paint your house. And that was done after the historic district was listed, but it was separate and independent from that. And there were many layers of engagement with the community before it was decided on as to whether or not that would be allowed. So asking yourself, well, wait a minute, it sounds like there's a correlation there. There are thousands of historic districts in the United States, and there's no scientific correlation between the two to show that there's any kind of zoning automatic that happens afterwards. It's always about a community later coming in and deciding for themselves that they want that level of stricter zoning regulation. So that's the logic behind it, how people have done it in the past. But as long as the community is just like, no, we don't want stricter zoning regulations, and they're involved in the county's voting process, then you won't have that go over top of it. It won't be that correlation.
Not all of those 600 properties would qualify.
So you have contributing and non-contributing. And it's going to be really difficult for any property that's built post-1970 from scratch to be contributing. And so those are also ones where somebody's just like, well, I'm in an historic district. Am I going to be regulated in any way? Well, not even, yeah, definitely not those. Those properties are going to be in the district, but there's not going to be any part of it that it acknowledges their contributions until the district gets much older and somebody revises it. So there's districts like the Port Royal Historic District that they, you know, it was done in the 1970s, one of the first historic districts in Virginia. And they didn't really talk about anything that was post-Civil War. You know, most of the town stock is post-Civil War, so I'm working right now and revising the Port Royal Historic District to include things all the way up to 1970, because there's so much of their building stock and their history is now past that Civil War period. And so some non-contributing buildings can eventually become contributing, but it takes another 20 or 30 years, and it takes people acknowledging them for such, and in most cases, the turnover in building stock means that most of that isn't going to last that long. Debbie, you've done it three times, so I want to make sure you turn.
On the DHR, are share grants still available, and if they are, can you explain to them?
Sure.
How they
the state has two primary primary funding streams for helping communities with large projects like this, and they work them on phases. The first from the Department of Historic Resources is called the cost share program, in which the county puts up half and the DHR puts up half. The DHR does all the administration, and then you take on a chunk of a project. So if you can imagine Arlington, everybody know where the city of Arlington is in Virginia? Okay, if I'm not mistaken, it's the smallest locality in Virginia, but they have done an architectural survey of every single building in Arlington. And they did it over, I think, 6 years, and they use monies from the cost share program every other year, and then they balanced it with something called the certified local government. Certified local governments are governments that essentially have structure that respect the historic integrity and the preservation focus within the county's structure. And the Department of Transportation has a specific amount of line item funding that's put aside for these CLGs every single year. There are so few CLGs in Virginia that they almost always get whatever projects that they're bidding on, usually in the range of like $10,000 to $15,000 a year. And a lot of times it's because you have an architectural review board and you want to get training for those people, so if they're going to comment on whether or not you can do something in a specific area where your zoning says you have control over that, then you're not just talking about somebody who feels like, you know, that architectural detail is silly and I don't like it. They'll have to bring fact. So they have training. In other cases, they have particular properties that have no funding for National Register, and so they try to focus on those. But for big projects like that, you get 10 to 15,000. You can start throwing and chipping away at the inventory side of things for projects as big as the Gwynn's Island Historic District might be. So those two programs, they are often used by the state to kind of inch towards working on projects like a Gwynn's Island Historic District that is really expensive. The state never has like $90,000 it can just throw towards a project. It's always trying to leverage their funds with county or with other state funds from other organizations. But those two areas are ways that I proposed about 3 or 4 years ago to go about doing something like this, just in internal conversations. And I mean, technically, if we had started 2 or 3 years ago, we might have been closer to completion, but these projects take time, and you have to wait for the right time, and public engagement's important, so sometimes we wait. There are other ways of securing funds, like you could go ahead and reach out to private funds, private foundations that have grants for historic preservation related activities, and working through other nonprofits, you know, preservation. Mathews could go ahead and pursue a grant from another private non-for-profit. You know, those are more difficult because you're going to have to advocate